Welcome to the Rebel Love Show. We are a once a week broadcast from Manchester, New Hampshire. We are pro pot, pro gun, and pro coffee. You can find all of our content at rebelloveshow.com. I am Ron Mathias.
And I'm his and your Rebel Mistress.
And today we have a special guest, none other than MVG Mattheus Von Guttenberg.
Is that like your stage name now, Mattheus? MVG? Have you just adopted that? Are you going to make a Facebook page?
No, not yet, but it's been growing on me.
Do you have a Facebook page yet?
Personal, not a professional page yet.
Do you have a website? You should at least have a website.
It exists. There's just no content on it. We've talked about this.
Yeah, every episode.
Well, that was a long time ago. I thought by now it would have.
No, I'm a slacktivist in that regard.
I understand. We're all slacktivists.
It's okay. So anyways, we got some updates to talk about because me and Ann here have a bunch of stuff going on later this month. Pretty much 2 weeks from now is going to be Keenevention. We are taking part in a total of four panels between the two of us. Four panels.
How many are you doing?
I'm doing three, which is a lot.
I'm doing two.
Yeah,
I think.
Yeah, so,
just two.
Keenevention is coming up this October 31st through the, no, 30th through the 1st? Yeah.
Yes, yeah, it's the 30th through the 1st.
Yeah, Friday through Sunday.
But it doesn't really start. I think everyone's just arriving Friday.
No, it starts Friday. I have a panel Friday.
Oh, okay. What time?
Oh, I don't know. It's on the schedule.
I was hoping to just get drunk as soon as I got there.
Well, I'm sure
you can do that.
That is what I'll do. I'll go to your speech, too.
Well, it's not a speech, it's a panel, but yeah,
I'll go to your panel.
You better go to all of them.
I'll be drunk at all of them.
You can be drunk and high and rolling at the same time, but you better be at the at those panels.
No, I'll be there. Last year was my first convention. It was your first convention too, correct?
Yes, it was my first one.
Oh, okay. Yeah, so I mean, I had a great time, and I wasn't seeing Rob here at the time, so
I know
yeah. It was one of the first major liberty events I had went to, and I went by myself, and I met someone who's like one of my best friends now, which is really amazing because we got back together at convention, and then
it was a convention miracle.
And I met my best friend Tila because we roomed together, and it was very It was just, I didn't know the girl, and we just roomed together, and we've been friends ever since. So I think Keenevention just brings people that you know you never probably would have met before together, and you know, I think that's great.
Well, that happens a lot of times at Liberty conferences where you'll run into people that you really meet for the first time, but you make connections at those locations, at those festivals or conventions or conferences or whatever you want to call them. Now I go there mostly just for the social networking part. Like I'm doing these talks and whatnot, and so are you, but I'm going there more for the social aspect than anything else.
Well, were you doing as much last year as you're doing now?
I was doing more last year than I am doing now. I've been a slacktivist.
What
this
were
year.
You doing
last year? I did last everything
year that you aren't doing now.
What was I doing last year that I'm not doing now?
Yeah.
I haven't done any jury nullification this year. Last year I was doing jury nullification left and right. I also
did
a shit ton
New Hampshire
of top blocking.
Independence? Outreach?
Yes, no, I've been doing that this year, and I did that last year.
Oh, you did that last year too?
You were also working a lot more last year.
Yeah,
I was.
You didn't have as much money last year.
I know. Last year, I...
Less money, more activism.
Yeah, last year, I was working at least 10 hours more a week, and I was traveling at least half the year last year. I had a round trip to work and back of 2.5 hours.
Mm. Mm.
And I still did more last year than I do this
year.
Well,
I'd make the argument you've done more because we don't cop block as much, but that's just because the cops are fair weather activists and they haven't had the checkpoints, but you've been getting pulled over. So you have your own season.
Well, yeah, the
season of Rob being pulled over.
The porcupines may have won the battle of the DOI checkpoint in Manch Vegas, but, they have that was just the battle. The war is still going on, and the cops keep coming after me.
You specifically.
Yeah.
Too,
me
so.
Specifically.
Have you been pulled over this year, Mattheus?
Have I been pulled over this year?
Yeah. Or last year? I don't know. You're kind of.
Yeah, no. I mean, I've had a number of times being pulled over. I pissed one of them off by not lowering my window all the way. That was actually, it's actually a funny story. I got pulled over off by Murphy's in front of the Market Basket on the east side.
Oh, wow.
And, he pulled me over. I had some problems with registration or inspection sticker. Some, I don't know. It's one of the catch-alls that they just pull you over and say, hey, you know, your tail light's out or something like that. And I ended up you know, kind of lowering my window a little bit, and he, you know, kind of gave me a command, like, you know, can you lower it the rest of the way or something like that. You know, he was kind of a,
they always come to my side of the car. Like, they're always, every time I'm in the car with Rob, they come to my side. I'm like, it's because I'm black
and a woman.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well,
double whammy.
Yeah. The last couple of times I've been pulled over, like, they always go to her window first, which doesn't make any sense. Like, I'm literally waving at the cop, like, hey, I'm over here.
It's not like we're in England where it's like, oh, they're driving on the right. Okay, I'll go that way then.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
I just like to pretend like they're not there. Like, they ask me questions and I'm just, he must not be talking to me because he doesn't exist.
I would caution you that sometimes to play with police, there's a couple magic words that you need to say. I don't want to see anybody else do what Amanda BillyRock did.
Yeah, don't pull a
say
Billy
nothing.
Rock.
Just to say absolutely nothing.
Well, I had the camera. He was talking. So.
There's a video of what he's talking
Rob's
about.
Talking, if there's someone communicating, but I'm just saying that, like, if you personally are approached and Rob's not there to talk or to say the magic words, that if you don't say the magic words, then they don't know that you speak English, or they don't know that you're not drunk, or they don't know that whatever. You know, Amanda just sat there for a minute.
I'm sorry, I don't know this story.
So,
oh my god.
So I don't know. It was
ancient. It's ancient history at this point.
What happened?
A year and a half ago, Amanda and I and Sandra are driving from Laconia down to Manchester. But before we can leave the city, she gets pulled over for whatever silly reasons, like we change lanes in a red light or something like that. And she didn't say a single thing. She opened the window and gave the documents and whatever, but she didn't say a single word. And she, you know, she didn't claim that she was expressing her Fifth Amendment right, or she didn't do anything, any of those incantations. And within like 45 seconds or a minute, the guy was threatening to break the window and like pull her out of the car. So there's just, you know,
and she got arrested for it.
The video, I remember, you know, the video is not on YouTube anymore.
Not anymore.
Yeah.
It's in my head.
Yeah.
But
I remember watching it. I remember.
Why isn't the video on YouTube?
Amanda had it removed.
Oh.
Yeah. She didn't want it to be public.
Yeah.
Well, no, she got arrested for it because she didn't say the magic words.
What,
like,
are the am I being detained?
No, it's like, I plead the Fifth Amendment. I have a right to remain silent. I choose not to answer questions. Anything at all that expresses that you know you have a right not to be questioned with or without a lawyer, if you mention anything like that at all and then you shut the hell up,
do you know
you'll
what
be mostly safe.
Neo Cash, Darren Taps, his magic words to the police are, I don't want to talk right now. And then they say, well, when do you want to talk? Later. That's what he says, and he just gets off every time.
That's so great. That's a great idea.
Probably won't work for me, though.
Wow. No, that never works for me. Well, nothing I've ever seen has really worked for me.
It's because of the beard. They just know you're not.
Well, it's because of all the fuck cop bumper stickers.
I'm taking up most of those fuck cop bumper stickers, too. There's only a couple left, and they're just so hard to take off.
I know.
Yeah.
You know?
Well,
I like to respond to them with questions, respond to their questions with questions. They'll ask a certain question. You know how fast you were going back there? Why do you want to know? Or why does it matter? Or what do you think? Right? Don't put it on me. How fast do you think I was going? Oh, well, I clocked you later. Whatever. You know, it's like it's putting it back on. There's, you know, there's different ways you can be creative about it. But if you're worried about like giving yourself away or saying or doing something illegal that you're worried about, then just say that you have a right to remain silent. You don't want to incriminate yourself. I won't talk without a lawyer here. Whatever. Any of those things will work. I have a Fifth Amendment right to silence. Any of those will work. But any kind of like, you just have to refer to that because that's the magic system for these people. That's like, you have rights 1 through 4 or 1 through 10, and you have to play them like cards on a table before they become active.
Okay.
See, one thing I always try to do is try to make it personal to the cop. So I always try to like break it down to like, you know, you realize you're stealing from me, you're threatening me with violence. Like,
yeah, how
know,
do they take it?
Like, this last cop said he would be if a warrant was issued for my arrest, he would gladly kidnap me.
He said, would you kidnap me over a light bulb issued?
Yeah. Would you kidnap me over a light bulb over my government issued
gladly.
ID license plate?
I'll come get you myself. It's like what he said. I mean, I find them hilarious and just how much of bullies they are. It's just blatant.
That's how cops are.
If worst comes to worst, will you be prepared? You don't have to be a survivalist to prepare for the unexpected. Storing necessary supplies like food, water, and emergency equipment is simply taking responsibility for ourselves and our families when it counts the most. StrategicShelters.com offers emergency supplies and a secure way to store them, and provides protection for loved ones in the event of an extreme natural or man-made disaster. To find out more, visit strategicshelters.com.
The warning signs.
First, he made me feel special. He promised he'd look after me, provide for my future.
Does it sure come up?
Does it what?
Come up?
I'm 2 feet tall.
Already. You can go down farther.
I don't want to go down farther.
You can't go up any farther. Well, you might be able to, but you have to push your chair back a little bit.
Things only got worse. And then whatever.
He started making my decisions for me.
Yeah.
About my job, my kids' education, my money.
Maybe I'll get a pillow for this chair just for me.
So I had that guy that pulled me over by Murphy's. Uh-huh. Right? It was like some taillight, whatever bullshit. And I ended up lowering my window like 2/3 of the way or halfway, whatever. And he told me to like lower it the whole way. And I tell him, it's fine. And he looks at me. It's fine. He said, yeah, I can hear you. Like, that's the should be the point of lowering the window, right? Is to communicate, whatever. It's like, I can hear you. Like, I can talk to you. And it just completely, like, threw him completely off of his, like, off his pitch, off his rehearsed line, you know, whatever. It was just, like, completely, like, oh, do you know why?
Yeah, no, I've gotten that so much, man. I've gotten that so much from different.
They're just really surprised that you're talking back to them, is the thing.
Yeah. Well, I think my car is kind of targeted in Manch, personally.
You think?
Like, that's kind of like my going assumption.
Yeah.
Considering I literally get pulled over once a month on the dot.
The cops came to my job and talked about what to do if there's an active shooter.
So they said, call us. We'll come by in like 20 minutes.
No, they're like, give us like the keys to all your doors. We got a brown package.
Oh, yeah.
For you. And like, we'll teach you how to get it ready. And, you know, we'll come and fuck shit up. You know, we'll get the bad guys.
We'll play ACDC while we do it.
Exactly.
Have fucking Brian Johnson screaming some Back in Black while we're just lighting up with machine guns.
Yeah, totally, it'll be nothing.
Totally Call of Duty right there.
Like, that's literally
we
what
can make this
it, like,
place your corporate work environment. We can make a Call of Duty. If there's an active shooter, please just call us. We'll be all too happy.
This is exactly what he sounded like. Just like this beefed up meathead.
There, it's weird. Like, sometimes I'll talk to cops where
he was like,
they're calm,
oh my God.
And sometimes they're like so
the best thing
roided
ever.
Up.
He said the best thing.
What? No.
I don't have any headphones.
You don't have headphones?
No.
Yeah, you do. There's headphones right there.
I get the broken headphones.
No, those are not the. Oh, they're all broken. The only one's not broken is his. This is duct tape too.
Well, anyway,
look,
the best thing he said was, he was like, don't hesitate, like, to tell me where you are. Like, say you're by the Dunkin' Donuts. Like, don't think it'll fit me. I know exactly where the Dunkin' Donuts is. And I was like, is this guy for real?
can you scoot your chair down?
I'm sitting up, so I don't, like, I'm.
Well, I know, but that sound gets picked up in the mic. I can hear it. With my headphones?
Yeah, but I won't be like moving when I'm on the show. If I scoot it down, we might as well not even record. Like, I'm like under the table.
And welcome back to the Rebel Love Show. During the break, we're having a conversation about our interactions with Mensch PD lately. And if you go to rebelloveshow.com, click on live, not only can you access the LRN chat, but you can also watch our studio cam here at the Rebel Love Studio. But anyways, Keenevention.
We should have a studio cam going like 24/7.
24/7.
Yeah. And then it just, everyone comes in here every now and then.
The Rebel Love reality show.
Yeah, just done something crazy, but it has to be like for anarchy.
Well, usually everything we do is for anarchy, babe.
That's
even
true.
When we have sex, we're having sex for anarchy.
Sure. So, Mattias, I think the question was, have you been pulled over this year? And I think you said no, but you've had Did we cum block at all this year?
I think we did once. Yeah.
No, a couple. Well, if I count, you know, when we get pulled over. Well, yeah, I guess you can make the argument that that was. But I'm saying when every time I get pulled over, that's an act of cop blocking.
Cop block.
Porkfest was the last time. Did they do any checkpoint this year? Checkpointing?
No, because we fucking won. That's why.
Okay, well, that's great.
They learned their lesson. They don't do checkpoints anymore in Manchester because we shut it down.
That's great. I'm glad.
I'm assuming that's the case. I don't know. I mean, I'm claiming victory for all Manchester activists. Whether that's the case, I don't know.
They're gonna start.
I'm going to do the same thing on the cop block panel at Keenevention. We're going to claim victory over DUI checkpoints on that panel. Just a fair warning for anyone who goes to Keenevention.
I kind of wish they would come out to play. You know, I kind of like. There's a certain sweetness. But I kind of like that they give us the opportunity to express our philosophy. You know, if there weren't cops, what would become of cop blockers and all that? Right?
No, I think that we should be cop blocking more. I'm glad I'm on the cop block panel because I hope this is a question. I don't think you need cops to be cop blocking to be teaching people about cop block. Mm-hmm. Like, cop block's a cool thing. Like, set up a booth somewhere, put a fucking giant cop block banner on top of that fucking booth and just stand there handing out pamphlets.
Right.
This is cop block. This is what it is.
Have Silver Dave and Pete Ayer standing by right next to you.
Yeah. Handing out pamphlets to people. Anyone who stops by, they can hear about it. Like, we don't need cops to cop block. And I think that is where we failed. That's where they won. Because we're not out there doing activism.
That's true.
And, you know, maybe that's what they wanted. So I feel like we should still be out there fighting because that's just a small battle. We got the war to win now. So Call of Duty.
Well, then get out there and...
Maybe after the cop block panel. I don't know. I feel like if one of the founders were here, back to what
Mattheus was saying, like the DUI checkpoints as an activist is fun.
Yeah, it is fun.
It's fun.
And it gives us a stage for other people to see what is going on.
I remember last year running into, there were Mexican immigrants that joined the cop block. They're like, yeah, we hate their cops too. And they like, they're all inside. They're not porkypies. They're not
they
even liberty activists.
Signs. They
thought it was so cool that people were doing this to a DUI checkpoint that they came out and like helped out, which was like a cool thing. And you know,
I find the best, first of all, cop block was one of my first activisms here. So
it was one of our first dates. Yeah.
And it really made me fall in love with all of this.
If you want to impress a lady, guys.
Yeah, take her cop blocking.
They love it.
Like it was very social. Like I walked down Elm Street with a sign on me that said "Police on Bridge," and you know how many people came up to me and hugged me, and kissed me, wanted to shake my hand. They were like, "Thank you." People are really appreciative, and each one of those people walked away learning like something they didn't know before. You know, we gave them some lit. I think lit is so important.
And even for the people that didn't like us, right? Even for the people that told us to
get a job
or do other things. At least they got to see more visually like evidence that there's opposition, there's other people out there that are expressing their ideas. And maybe, you know, if we can think of their receptivity to our ideas, like on a number line, maybe they went from like -4 to -3, you know, maybe they still think we're stupid or hate us or wrong or whatever, but maybe they're getting closer and closer to being like, okay, well, I'm starting to be culturally, you know, shifted towards this new, this new perspective.
Well, I will say this in Manchester compared to like, the rest of the country, just, I would say New Hampshire period, locals know what cop block is. Like a lot of locals do, like our old apartment. Our neighbor said he had gone cop blocking before. The people below us, not only do they support cop block, they had like a cop block stickers on their window, on like the door getting into their apartments.
Right.
They saw me coming up. Whenever I go jogging, I always wear my cop block hoodie. So like they saw that and they're like, "Oh, do you cop block?" And blah, blah, blah. And I was like, "Yeah, yeah." And they wanted lit. So like I have a bunch of those cop block door hangers.
Sure,
so like they wanted those. So like everyone around us, like all of the apartments around us had like cop block door hangers around and everything.
Wow.
So But those weren't porcupines.
Yeah.
No. You know, those weren't, normal, you know, other libertarians or anarchists. Right. Those were just locals that also know the cops suck.
Well, it's a really good method to build, I would say, like, the widest bridge, right? So, like, you know, the idea of police brutality or being against the police power in this country or being scared or being worried about it or whatever is such a broad overlap, right? There's so many people that feel that way. And that is one of our kind of core, you know, like, implications of our belief system, or not belief system, but our system of thought, that it's so easy to build bridges with those people. You know, I remember working at, you know, the slave job before the slave job before the slave job.
That was a horrible slave job, by the way. I remember when you had that slave job. I was rooting for you, man. I'm glad I was able to kind of help you get out of that one slave job.
That's true. Well, even the slave job that I went after that with your help, I remember I talked to customers.
That was still a shitty slave job. That was still a slave job. I hate saying it was great.
Oh, yeah. But I remember a time I talked to at least a couple people that would that made some kind of comment about police, and we ended up talking about cop lock, and they knew what cop lock was, and, you know, we kind of had a conversation, and I remember, I guess I wasn't, you know, I wasn't busy or something, I was caught up with some woman talking, and I kind of showed her behind the curtain a little bit, because she was a fan of the cop locking that was going on, and that, you know, that stuff, and I kind of let her in and said, you know, that there's an underground, you know, movement here, or this underground, you know, group of people that are doing this in Manchester and so forth. And I told her a little bit about the Free State Project. That's an easy sell.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, you don't have to travel very much distance to get from A to B. Those overlap pretty cleanly.
No, I hear you on that. It's definitely a thing that helps relate to locals more, and just people in general, because people know that the cops are usually not always the good guys.
Yeah, not there, you know, to serve and protect you.
Yeah, they serve and protect their own interests their own jobs usually, because those tickets that they always issue,
right?
You know, that's going to fund their.
It's indirectly funding them.
Yeah,
that's their Christmas bonus.
Well, at least their cars used to say "serve and protect." Some of them don't even say that anymore, but it always left it open. Whom are they serving and protecting?
Just them.
Keenevention is coming up fast, October 30th through November 1st. Get your tickets now at keenevention.info. Keenevention is an intimate event where you can meet dozens of key liberty activists from across the Shire, including Oathkeeper Chris Reitman, Libertarian presidential candidate Daryl W. Perry, illegal Uber driver Christopher David, NeoCash Radio's Dr. Darren Tapp, State Representative Mike Sylvia, rated an A+ by the NHLA, the Seditious Sirens, the Rebel Love Show's Rob Mathias, tech guru Brian Sovereign, cop blocker J.P. Freeman, new mover Dr. Taryn Lupo, longtime political activist Dennis Goddard, Church of the Invisible Hand minister Rich Paul, Shire Dude, and dozens more. Only 100 tickets are available in advance, so lock yours in now for just $60 or with Bitcoin. That includes access to the Halloween costume dance party. Reserve your tickets now at keenevention.info. Visit keenevention.info
for more speaker announcements. He's what?
He's training.
Training what?
To be a studio dog.
No, he's going to be the new studio cat. I'm training him to be like Ash.
You wish.
Oh, I was the commercial for 101's playing right now, and I was talking to this guy that apparently does a podcast from Arkansas, and he's moving here. He's moving to Rochester. His name is Roger Paxton.
Rochester, New Hampshire.
Yeah, he's moving there. He does a show that has a really long acronym. I'm not a fan of acronym shows.
Gotcha.
Anyway, I mean, it's like a newsy show that targeted toward anarchists. I mean, we're a voluntarist polyamorous show, so hell, to each his own on the niches, right? But in the episode, the last one he released talked about him and his wife and kids moving here. Nice. And he started talking about how this documentary, 101 Reasons, was like the catalyst. Like, that was his trigger.
Nice.
All right. Like, you know, and he starts listing all the things that, like, why New Hampshire is great based off of that movie, damn, that documentary.
That's awesome.
Yeah. It was really cool to hear that, because I remember that being filmed. You know, I remember that being created. And it's cool that someone else out there, like, that's that got them into this.
You should tell Ellie that story. I think she'd like to hear that.
Oh yeah,
she was the.
I know she's the face of that movie. Yeah, I forget that. You know, I used to listen to her and her on. I remember listening to her on Am Kokesh's podcast when she and Derek went down to Virginia.
Yeah.
So it's weird when I see her. Like, I remember you, like, listening to you in my head, like, yeah, 4 years ago.
That's funny.
You know?
What did she do? She did Ladies and Keen with Cecilia. And she did ALP with Ellen. And then she did some Free Talk Live.
Yeah, I was going to say, I remember her being on Free Talk Live. And then she did Kokesh for a while.
Kokesh was somewhere in there as well. That employers
are checking. Every hire is under the microscope these days.
Second,
they won't just be checking references you provide. Figure that all of your ex-employers will get a call and be asked, would you hire him or her again? Third, assume you will be Googled. So before you apply, remove all those party animal photos from your Facebook page.
Even if you're doesn't this already break the fourth wall? Effective
communication skills. What do you mean it does it already break the fourth wall?
The passing of the piece.
Oh, and this is really cool. Like, she's going to pass it to me. I'm going to have it on camera, so I'm going to bring it up to the camera. I'm going to flip the switch, and it's going to come right down over on this side.
That's what I mean, though. It's like,
well, I'll break it out to the other camera angle from time to time. And become an amplifier at amp.lrn.fm. That's amp.lrn.fm.
And welcome back to the Rebel Love Show. Before we left, we were talking about what we're pretty much always talking about. Fuck the police. and just our interactions in Manchester in general. But mainly we were talking about Keenevention. And that is one of the panels that me and Rob are both on. So yeah, That'll be fun to talk about and share with you.
Well, it's exciting because I've never been on a panel with you before.
I know.
So it's going to be exciting. It's going to be like the Rebel Love Show. It's doing a panel.
I know. It's like we've taken over that panel. It's our panel now.
Well, it's LJP. That's our panel now. You know, yeah. But I'm looking forward to the Cop Block panel. I'm also going to be on the tech panel, which is moderated by Brian Sovereign. Dennis Goddard's on
the
there.
The tech panel is going to be so nerdy.
Stephanie Murphy. Oh, yeah. You know what time it is?
What time?
It is at 9:30 a.m. on Sunday.
Oh, baby, God. Get one free pass panel.
What's hilarious, like, that was actually supposed to be the time for the secession panel, which I'm moderating. And Ian's like, oh, you think you can switch times with till Friday because Brian and Stephanie are doing another convention somewhere. I forget what convention they're doing on Saturday, and they're coming to Keenevention on Sunday. I'm like, yeah, thank God, I don't want to do that 9:30 a.m. shift. And then, like, Brian Sovereign, like, immediately messaged me, oh, hey, like, do you want to be on this panel? I'm like, fuck yeah, I'll do the panel. It's like, I jumped out of my chair for like 30 seconds and like joy that I didn't have to wake up Sunday morning, and then I have to again.
I don't even know what time any of my panels are, so I hope I get a schedule.
Out of the frying pan into the fire, man.
Yeah, but anyways, the tech panel also has Stephanie Murphy on there and Steve Zemanek, which both of them were on it last year. They did fantastic. And Stephanie Murphy is, like, you know, there's so many Bitcoin gurus, including Mattheus right here, but there's so many Bitcoin gurus in the Shire, it's hard to keep up. And then, babe, you and Renee is moderating, but you are on the, is it the ladies panel?
Yes, it's the ladies panel.
I thought it was the sexist panel for a second, because it seems like there's only one gender on that panel.
Just because there's one gender, it doesn't make it sexist. Oh, okay. You know what is sexist? Telling women that they should only wear dresses.
No.
In quotations.
Where did this go?
Rob Mathias.
Wait.
Where is this going?
Wait a second. How is that in any way sexist? That's just my preference.
Well, I think the ladies panel will be very beneficial because I think that, you know, there is a difference. Like, there's physically a difference between women and men. And when we move into this community, like, we have different challenges because of our gender. I don't think it's, you know, all about dividing us. I think we should all really be together. But I think that ladies have opinions that may differ, and there may be some things that people want to hear, such as like the dating aspect from a female perspective, creepertarians from a female perspective.
Oh, that's valuable.
And I feel like a lot of the times, you especially, guys are just
especially
like
me.
Yeah, guys are just like, well, you know, we can judge it from our perspective of it, but you can't see things from my perspective until you can ask me a question and I can tell you about it. But if you don't have someone to ask, how will you ever know, you know? So I feel like the ladies panel is going to be nice, and I think there's some great ladies that Renee picked.
Who's
I
got
to give it to her. So it's me, it's Ellen Ball or Stallone, and she's so smart. I feel like she's on the tech. Is she on the tech panel? No, she's
no, but she will panel. Be on the succession panel.
Okay, yeah. I mean, Ellen's just very inspirational. I think it'll be great to listen to her talk about her perspective because she moved here and she started in Keene with a boyfriend, and her story just took off from there.
Well, this is the Divorce State Project.
Whatever.
Everyone comes here with somebody sometimes,
Danica's,
and they all don't stay with those people.
On the panel, Danica's also on the panel. I don't know her very well, but I mean, she's really nice the times I have met her. And Katie McCall, which was, I told Renee that she should definitely ask her to be on because it's good to get an aspect from someone who's a mother and she does a lot of stuff in the community involving children. And I feel like it's a great mix of women, and we can all talk about our different perspectives of moving here and what it's been like for us so far. And if you don't want to hear it, you know what? Don't come. It's not sexist.
Oh, babe, I want to hear it. I'm not saying I don't want to hear it. I didn't say anything of the kind. Anyways, there's also the succession panel. I moderated that last year. First off, I am a board member for the Foundation for New Hampshire Independence. We've done some outreach and activism this year, but not as much as I wanted to. Mattheus here helped out during July 4th,
yeah,
which was awesome.
That was a fun
That was an
rally.
Awesome day, especially yeah. when we got to confront the government. No, I did not get it on camera, which was a activist.
I didn't know it was like that
well,
big of an event.
It definitely wasn't activism then.
I know, it wasn't on camera.
Yeah, it didn't happen.
It lacks the necessary quality.
Yeah.
And the sufficient quality of being videotaped.
This will
there is
forever
no such thing as activism
mock us.
Unless it's not on camera.
Correct.
This will forever be our downfall that we didn't get that on camera.
Well, I got a picture. At least I got a picture. I somehow got my phone to snap one picture.
Yeah, the picture looks so funny because it's just Renee
shaking hands with the governor. Yeah,
yeah,
I know.
But you see me with the, you know, the propaganda in my hand. So
yeah.
There's a giant flag that like pierced through the crowd, made its way from one corner to the other corner.
Oh, yeah.
What's
the next event that you guys are going to do?
We want to do another Bruins edition at some point. I would like to see us do a fundraiser to do some more, like to do actually propaganda in regards to TV commercials or radio.
What kind
commercials.
Of fundraiser would you do?
Oh, it'd have to be something baller.
Something baller.
Something baller. Yeah.
What would you
class.
Pay money for, Mattheus?
Yeah, if there was a succession fundraising events, a gala, if you will. What would you want to see and how much would you pay for it?
Wow, a gala. So will there be dancing? Will there be music?
Sure.
I'm thinking dancing and music. Well, yeah. Maybe you want to bring a crowd that has the appropriate funds to donate. So maybe not too much music. Maybe light music, like a guitar.
Okay. Well, anyways, I like to do something like that in regards to getting some sort of advertisement. I would love to see because so many people who are politicos listen to like conservative and liberal like talk radio. Like I would love to have like that enter into those fears, you know, of like about leaving the union and all that jazz.
Well, tell people where they can find New Hampshire Independence if they want to donate and leave some ideas.
org. Go check it out. Also on that same panel, Ellen will be on. She's also a board member on the foundation. So is Chandler Gable, who was on the first succession panel 2 years ago at the first Keenevention, and he blew it out of the water on that one. So I'm really excited.
You weren't there. Oh,
no, but it's YouTube. On YouTube. I watched it. It was a great panel. That was actually the first thing I watched from Keenevention last year.
Oh, that's
and then Mark Wharton is going to be on, a former state rep, and also
Silver Fox.
Yeah, I know. You always got to say that whatever. If anyone mentions Mark Warren's name, the first thing you have to say is, oh, he's a silver fox.
That is one good-looking man.
Anyways, Mr. Porcupine Realtor himself will be on the panel. And then also Dennis Goddard's going to be on. So we're doing like two panels together, it seems. He's actually part of the Director of Research of New Hampshire Liberty Alliance, which is really huge in the politico world of going into the matrix.
Right.
In regards to the state house and the liberty bills that go through, and anyways, he's also going to be on the secession panel.
Yeah, I've met him several times and I didn't know any of that.
It's weird. I'll meet people as we travel through the Shire and whatnot, and I don't even really know like their background.
Like, you're just meeting people who've done, like, these awesome things, yeah, and you're like, just not aware.
I know Carlos Morales for, basically keeping the same look, drinking, and playing guitar. I don't know him for being a CPS whistleblower.
More when we come back.
Free Talk Live.
Ellen was like, who is that? And I told her. And then she was like, oh my God, why didn't you tell me before? I went over there like an idiot. Like, I should go over there and talk to him about something like inspirational, because she was just like so impressed with all he had done.
Murdoch does a lot of shit down in Texas. Awesome. He makes us look like chumps.
Yeah.
Like, he's out there doing it.
But he doesn't have a 9-to-5, so you know
he
what?
He sometimes works, like, long hours. He has a full-time job.
Oh, I thought he worked, like, a, like, flexible schedule, and I don't know. What does he do? I thought he was just one of those guys who didn't, like,
I don't want to talk about what his personal work is on air. I know what it is, but I'm not going to. We're on YouTube. We're still on YouTube. Mics are hot.
Oh, I thought you muted.
I only mute during the bumpers. Well, everything you say in the breaks.
I don't care.
Breaks.
He's a great guy.
So no, yeah, he's fantastic. Yeah. This is your Roberts Brookridge daily. Yeah,
No, I thought I asked him. I didn't know he did anything. But anyway, he has a lot more free time than this. Silver is up 6 cents at
$15.95. Yeah.
He doesn't do a podcast, okay?
No, he is working on a podcast. He's working on a radio show.
He's working on.
Yeah. That takes a lot. This doesn't just happen.
To be a guest.
You know, I'm not like you and waking up flawless. Like, it takes a lot of work.
Mattheus, did you get to meet Murdoch much? Or?
Yeah, he was a cool dude. I remember him.
Well, he's going to be in the wedding, too, so you guys will get to know him.
Yeah, nice. He does all the open carry activist stuff in Texas. Yeah. Yeah, he's cool. Hey, Rob, I forgot what the password for the Wi-Fi is.
I don't even remember.
Wait.
I've been told no in many different ways.
Okay.
Hey, you gotta tell me what you don't want people to know or not.
I'm sorry. I don't want you giving out the passwords to like our internal network on the internet.
Our internal network password is so like, easy. You know,
I may not be the Mr. Encryption on everything, which I'm not.
2016.
I mean, I texted a few people via encryption, but
no,
like,
it's because people like get your first of all, you're a slacktivist and a half. Like, I'll wait till we come back on here.
No, it's good. I shouldn't have asked in the first place.
No, it's okay. It's a good test. It's a good test to see what she would do, and she failed.
Whatever. What you would do if you would let it go on the air.
But yeah, you should have muted.
Hey, I did it right. I hit the mute button. I'm trying to get better at that too. I did that when I coughed. I don't know if you noticed. That was the first time I've ever actually done it. I always like cough to the side. Like, fuck, I have a mute button.
Yeah, we really should mute. Derek J got pissed at me once when I sneezed.
Really?
Yeah, you were in here.
Yeah. Dude, sorry, you were loud.
It was a sneeze. What am I supposed to do?
What were you supposed to do?
Not sneeze, hold it. You know, I did that once. My head spun around in a circle. All
right. Anyways, when we come back, we're done talking about Keenevention. We've talked about 45 minutes. I'm done talking about that.
But we didn't even talk about the Hall. Can we just come back and finish it off by saying the Hall of the King dance party, we're going to win the competition, and Renee's a slut. For free to answer any of we don't have to say the last part, but...
Did you see her relationship status today?
Yeah,
what the fuck? What the fuck?
Oh my god. Are the mics...
Who cares? She talks about this shit on air all the time. She talks about this all the fucking time.
You don't want to talk about... No. No.
Okay, I'm not saying who it is.
And welcome back to the Rebel Love Show. Before we left, we were just talking about Keenevention and how awesome it's going to be. So everyone, get your tickets. Come out. They listen to Bitcoin some panels. People. They do take Bitcoin. I mean, it's at a great hotel. Like, they say do things, but really, you know, we did everything we wanted in that hotel last year. And yeah, I mean, everything. So, come out, have some fun with us, and... at the end, or no, the beginning to kick it off is the Halloween dance party.
No. The Halloween dance party is the Saturday nights of Keenevention, which will be our 1 year anniversary of getting back together, babe.
Oh, yeah.
And we're gonna have to have a little special dance on the dance floor. Just
should I be as drunk as last time?
Yes, but no, I take it back.
Not
you can't
as
be,
drunk.
But I'm gonna honor, I'm gonna honor the event by rolling as hard as I can. That night. So I'm hoping you'll do the same.
Well, anyway, there will be a costume contest in which we are going to win. Who won last year?
There wasn't a contest last year.
There was a contest.
No, there was. Oh, yeah. Uh-huh. There was.
The girl, she had a skeleton.
No, not her.
I thought she won.
James Cleveland won. Robin Hood.
He did not win.
Yes, he did.
James Cleveland did not win.
Yeah, he dressed up as motherfucking Robin Hood.
We will have to ask the prophet. Oh, prophet.
Robin Hood.
Oh, prophet. Peace be upon him. If you can hear us now, who won the Halloween dance contest, costume contest last year? Just answer us if you're here, prophet. Maybe he'll come.
He's not there.
Okay. Well, he's not there, so we'll never know. But I'm sure it was a woman who won because women are favored in the Shire. That's what the sexist panel is about.
Well, yeah, that's why you guys have your own dedicated panel.
They are the fairer sex.
Yeah. So, Mattheus here. You wrote a interesting article on because you're the Bitcoin guru. You're the Bitcoin guy.
You know, maybe that should be your Facebook page.
Bitcoin guru. Is there a Bitcoin guru page? I'm sure there is.
I don't know. Maybe.
It doesn't matter. Anywho, you did you wrote up a piece on Bitcoin.com about the low-hanging fruit of Bitcoin adoption, where you basically said all of our struggles to get some, you know, little retail place, some mom-and-pop coffee house to accept Bitcoin is... basically wasting our time.
Right, yeah. That's a pretty good summary.
I mean, is that a decent summary?
It's not a waste of time, I guess, but it's a complete diversion and distraction compared to, you know, I think what's a much larger market and much easier goal. It's just about selling, you know? You sell to who needs it most.
I found some interesting things about Bitcoin. I had never really read fully articles on it. Like, I knew what it was. I knew the basic concepts. But when I read your article, I actually looked up some more stuff because I just wanted to know about its origins and kind of how it originated, to kind of put everything you're saying and just put it into view for me. And I found out some very interesting things. And I don't know if everyone's just like, can even Bitcoin, because some people don't know what it is and they're just like, oh, fun money. Like, I remember what's Davi Barker said, his wife lets him use Bitcoin because she's like, oh, that's fine. He's just spending all this money on Bitcoin, like thousands of Bitcoins, because he's like doing his business.
Right. She doesn't consider the Bitcoin that he has as part of their income or like what they have. So like he can just mess around with it. She doesn't.
Interesting.
Yeah. I mean,
I don't know if you even talk about that on here. But
I mean, a lot of people know what Bitcoin is, I think, but maybe not the whole, all the tech behind it and where it originated and the blockchain and all that history. Because if someone's just coming into Bitcoin, and as the article said, I mean, Bitcoin took on a mind of its own, or it's like its own thing now. So people can just hear about it and then go get an app. You know, they don't know like Satoshi. What is it?
Satoshi Nakamoto.
Yeah. They don't know all that stuff. So I find that very interesting, because even I don't know how long has Bitcoin been around?
I'd say for almost 6 years. I think January 2009.
That's about right.
Software kind of got pushed out. So,
and that's it.
Maybe 5-6 years, I'd say.
And that's just a rate of exponential growth to the point where I think socially that someone can just download Bitcoin now, just download an app and just hear about it once, versus, you know, all the people who did all the research behind it. And you know, they were like it's weird. I know some people who, you know, they had Bitcoin when it was just like however much it started, and now they're just like stacking money in like their closet.
Well, it started at zero.
Yeah, it didn't start ever at any value for over a year. It didn't have any value at all.
Oh, yeah. Okay. So there's a bunch of people that had Bitcoin at zero. Basically nothing at all, or pennies.
Right.
That, you know.
Do you know any of those people?
You know some of those people.
I don't know how long they've had it. I was thinking when it was launching or something.
There are Bitcoin barons in this neighborhood.
I mean,
just down the block.
It makes sense how we got all these activists who don't have to go to work.
Yeah, well, a lot of those barons, in all honesty, are probably they're holding on for a long time. I mean, even then, but they're on the belief, just like Mattheus here, that you don't hold on to Bitcoin and wait for the price of Bitcoin to go up to sell it. You hold on to Bitcoin is when that is the currency,
right? Yeah, right.
You don't want to. You're not really doing it so you can get $1 million,
right?
Like, you're gonna hold it to like where that is that is everything.
It's a question of looking at what's your unit of account. If your unit of account is dollars, if you're interested in acquiring dollars, or if you're looking at this from a dollar fiat perspective, then the goal is to maximize your dollar revenues, your dollar income. And so you just buy low and sell high, right? But sell is a very critical part. You can't stay in the equity or stay in the asset forever, right? The point is to go back to dollars. But if you're looking at it from a Bitcoin perspective, like from the Bitcoin world, your unit of account is Bitcoin. So you would not want to get rid of any of that for some kind of alternate currency or alternate value system. You would be interested in how many units of the slices of Bitcoin could I get regardless of the price. So it would, you know, And from the person that's in that perspective, from the Bitcoin perspective, that uses that as their unit of account, it's experiencing pretty rapid price deflation, right? Everything's getting cheaper over time in terms of Bitcoin, mm-hmm. right? And so the purchasing power kind of is climbing, not necessarily year over year, because you can look at, you know, the bubble and so forth and claim whatever you want. But just over the 5 or 6 year period, the growth is, you know, undeniable.
So, but do you think it's smart then? So say for instance, we go to that place and they're selling beers for a millibit.
Sure.
Should people really be, you know, using it that way? Like continuously trading it that way? Or should they do the smart thing and, you know, just not necessarily hold on to it, but make purchases that count with it. Because I feel like, you know, spending like a mill a bit here, that's kind of like saying, oh, this is funny money.
Right. Like, right.
No, it's not.
No, I think, I mean, I encourage people to actually be hoarders, to hoard Bitcoin and to not spend it, because hoarding is what gives money value. It's what gives it purchasing power. If all the hands are grabbing for it, everyone's just bidding for how many goods they're going to give away for money. So I think that if you want to see Bitcoin's price increase and its value increase, hold on to it and resist the temptation to spend it on Overstock or on, you know, a Dell's website or whatever. Even though prices are falling in terms of Bitcoin, you know, over time, I would resist that urge. I would hoard as much as you can. But I mean, I'm not even, you know, I'm not perfect. I'm no saint. I got my haircut with Bitcoin, so I do spend it occasionally, right? But it's why it's nice important haircut, to have, like,
hey, I'll be honest, it is cool. When you
I had a beer right beforehand too. Yeah,
when you go in the barber's tool shed and you pay with Bitcoin, it is cool.
I agree. Know? We talked about, like, he was asking me questions about fiat currency and could Bitcoin displace like a bad country's currency, and we went into this whole discussion of how it's viral actually, like. I think the way that Bitcoin will succeed is not necessarily by like mainstream consumers adopting it for their, you know, to save 2% at Target or whatever, but it'll be from the point of view of people who invest in money as currency, as an asset. So if Bitcoin, let's say, displaces some country's native fiat currency, like if, you know, South Africa were to adopt Bitcoin, we would see dramatic effects on how it affects other countries as well.
Speaking of Africa.
Yeah, we'll talk about Bitcoin Africa after the break.
Are you getting squeezed by the economic downturn? Hey, you were doing fine. Then all of a sudden you're having a tough time paying your family's credit card bills. Maybe you were downsized or even lost a job, but you still owe 10 grand or more in credit card bills. And you just can't afford the minimum payments anymore. We're here to help. We are the Genesis Debt Partners. We know the secrets to negotiate better terms with your creditors. Make a free 10-minute call right now and learn how we can help you get out of debt. 800-981-7590. If you owe 10 grand or more in credit card debt and you want to learn how you can pay less and get out of debt faster, call right now. 800-981-7590. 800-981-7590. Get out of debt now. 800-981-7590.
There comes a time when you need custom embroidered or screen printed apparel for your business, organization, or a special event. Corporate Casuals has been helping people create great looking logoed apparel for over 25 years. They can produce a single piece or thousands using name brand apparel like Nike, Patagonia, Adidas, and Hanes. Create your logo in their online embroidery design studio or upload your existing logo and they'll turn it into embroidery. Go to corporatecasuals.com/FTL and include FTL in the order notes and save 5% on your order.
Did you know you can get news updates about what's happening with the Liberty Radio Network delivered in the way you prefer? You can sign up for our email updates at updates.lrn.fm. Plus, you can stay in the loop by joining our Facebook profile at facebook.lrn.fm or follow us at Twitter at twitter.lrn.fm. It's all free. So sign up now at updates.lrn.fm for news updates delivered to your email box, facebook.lrn.fm to follow our Facebook page, and twitter.lrn.fm to receive our tweets. More Rebel Love Show is next, live after the news, here on the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.fm.
From Keene in the Shire, the Liberty Media capital of the world, this is Daryl W. Perry, host of FPP Radio News for Tuesday, October 13th, 2015. Silver is trading at $15.85 per ounce. Gold is valued at $1,159 per ounce. And according to BitcoinAverage.com, the average price of Bitcoin is $251. Antiwar.com reports Syria's largest people's protection unit, YPG, have announced they are joining a new rebel faction, initially dubbed the subsequently renamed the Democratic.
Okay, so these guys in Ghana who want to have a Bitcoin conference.
Militias, along with an Assyrian Christian faction. Yeah, the group is said to be made up of about 32 fighters overall, though this is likely primarily the YPG itself, who controls significant territory in the Hasa
Cool. province. It's a Bitcoin activist.
Oh, wait, they want to, I got their little, they want to raise $2,100 to have a conference.
The promise of a massive influx of U.S. weapons into this new faction, however, likely was sufficient to get them on board. U.S. military officials were quoted as saying they were
going
to
provide
fresh weapons to the new faction and get them to attack Raqqa, the capital of the Islamic State Caliphate. The rebels have expressed confidence that they can capture the city in less than 2 months if given enough weaponry. Though most U.S. efforts to arm rebels have ended up with the Islamic State coming out even stronger at the end and with a bunch of new U.S.-made weapons.
They're
going to
have a lot of people there.
Yeah. Online.
Whether you're and looking for precious the location metals, is to be determined. Books,
you'll find that and
see, this is what, okay, this guy messaged me, okay? And he goes, hello, how are you, sir? Nice being friends with you here. Am Richard Suman, the president of bitunit.cryptoavenue.com. And our mission is to ignite and unite the market spirit of Africa through cryptocurrency. I go, hi, that sounds like a noble effort. I think I was high when I sent that. He goes, thank you. We are working on coming out with a Bitcoin and blockchain technology. See that right there, that line was like weird.
Yeah.
And I responded back and said, just use Bitcoin. Why reinvent the wheel? I will like share with my newly article, he says.
Yeah.
Hi. AfricaFreak.com/blog. Will Ghana be the catalyst for a Bitcoin revolution in Africa? That's my newly article. Newly article. I don't know. That's weird.
Well, maybe English was not the dude's first language.
Well, yeah.
Yeah, I know, right?
So he's the president and founder. His name is Colors.
Over the last I was going to say lower it for the camera for a second. Just lower it in the camera.
No.
Anyways.
Name Colors.
Does it seem legit or not?
He goes, we are working on coming out with an upcoming Bitcoin conference. After this seminar, Africans can start accepting Bitcoin. And I respond, anyone with a smartphone can do that now. Like, why do I need this conference for people to start using Bitcoin? Like, then they can start using Bitcoin.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I talked with these guys and I interviewed them on Flaming Freedom. And it was just like, they have to pay all these speakers. They're traveling. They're transporting all these people there. And they have to get the conference room. And, like, I'm sure they got to feed these people or, like, have them somewhere to stay. And they're only asking for $2,100.
Maybe there's a lot of money over there. Indefensible
and maybe.
No sentence had been announced. Barron said the guilty verdict. Maybe that buys them a lot more than their fiat currency.
Iran has behaved unconscionably throughout the case. The contemptible end to this justice process leaves Iran
he sells with an obligation
to right this grievous wrong. The Iranian
and
government
for Zion of
collecting confidential information.
That sounds somewhat.
He
makes necklaces?
Yeah, for
acting against national
necklaces, not bombs. Is that like his catchphrase? It should be.
And challenged Iranian President Hassan Rouhani to correct it. This has been FPP Radio News.
How is this a great website?
Do you think that fits in the studio?
Yeah.
Do you think it's a cool piece of art to have in here?
Yeah, I do. It looks cool. Okay. Bitcoin.bomb spray painted and signed by Dolly Parton.
Yeah, it's a bit. It's not on the studio cam.
I don't know why it's so low.
But I have a Davi original. It's a political sign, but it's a Bitcoin.bomb logo that he spray painted on it. And I actually have it framed that I bought it from him at Porkfest with Bitcoin. and I framed and put on the wall for the studio. It seemed fitting for a studio like artwork.
Sure, yeah, I agree.
It's like, especially for this show.
It's got a certain kind of like...
So I go to register...
kind of rebelliousness to it.
Yeah.
I go to register for blockchain in Africa for the conference, which is November 27th through the 29th. And there are no tickets currently available.
Maybe they're sold out?
Sold out.
Damn.
Damn.
And welcome back to the Rebel Love Show. And last we spoke a whole break ago here on LRN.FM, we were talking about Bitcoin and going after the hanging fruits and Bitcoin. We kind of got into Bitcoin in Africa. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. We were talking about Bitcoin in Africa. I did an interview with these guys. I'm sorry. Let me just pull up their Facebook page here. I'm not perfect, guys. So they're BitUnit Ghana. You can check them out on Facebook, BitUnit, one word, Ghana. And they're trying to organize a Bitcoin conference in Africa, and they're asking people to donate. I think their goal is $2,100. And their goal is to get everyone in the conference to leave with Bitcoin, and in hopes that Bitcoin will, you know, stimulate their economy or whatever, and then that will become the main currency, because he feels like that is how, you know, they'll fix their economic problems. So I found that to be an interesting theory, and I just want to know what you thought about, you know,
it sounds like Bitcoin activists' wet dream.
Yeah, no, I think it's a really noble cause. And I think that it's targeting the right people. Or, I mean, I don't know specifically if it's the Ghanaian people that need it most, but I'm just saying I think it's much better looking at that type of market or at those types of lifestyles over there that need Bitcoin much more than trying to pitch it to Western, you know, high-tech consumers. you know, like the need for that kind of financial instrument just isn't there, right? It's a novelty. It's kind of like a computer novelty, right? That now you can, oh, there's this new money that is on the internet that you can buy digital goods with. It's like, what a great innovation, you know, that somebody could guess maybe Apple did it or something like that.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's obviously much larger than that, but convincing the people, you know, the banking is plentiful. You know, I have bank account and I have credit cards and I have loans of various types and I can take a personal loan out and get credit, right? I have access to a lot of different credit facilities. And if you don't, right, if you don't have access even to a checking account, or you do have a checking account but you can't use it to send money anywhere out of the country, for instance, which is the case of like 2 billion people currently, and you know, another 2 billion or 3 billion don't even have a checking account, right? It's only about 1 billion people in the world that get the privilege of having a checking account with, you know, demand deposits that they can safeguard, you know, hold there, and that they can be sent internationally, maybe a seventh of the world or so. And so Andreas makes this point about looking at the other 6 billion people and looking at the need for something like Bitcoin, that it just enables them to access global markets instantly, that enables them to trade, you know, assured that there was no tampering with the money supply that they're using, right, that they'll never have to go back to wheelbarrows being more valuable than the cash they contain, right? Like in Weimar Germany and things like that. So there's a lot of advantages to using Bitcoin over people that are being oppressed by an inflationary fiat currency, you know, and legal tender laws and things like that. But this is just like, you know, a very uphill battle trying to do it here, trying to pitch it as some kind of e-commerce innovation or new payments rail for this or that. You know, I think it's lower hanging fruit to try to improve the infrastructure for sending money across seas and
for
develop their own economies on it.
For third world countries, absolutely, because there's so many immigrants here that, you know, if you're in the United States and you have family elsewhere on the planet, you know, and you're coming here to like make some sort of living and send money back,
right?
You know, why would you use like a, you know, any kind of money transfer service unless it is Bitcoin, because you're getting almost all of it to them.
Well,
immediately,
seconds
from your smartphone, you just press a button.
That's true. That does, in some defense, that does require that person to also have a market for their Bitcoin that they get, and if their local merchants take Bitcoin, then that's great. Chances are they don't, right? If you're sending money back to Indonesia or to Kenya or to whatever, chances are the people that they're going to be buying bread and so forth from don't accept Bitcoin. So the question of, okay, how do we get Bitcoin into whatever their native currency is, right? Then Bitcoin is a medium of exchange without really being a unit of account or anything like that. Which is fine, which is, I guess, what it needs to be at that stage. But that, like, kind of that last bit is the difficult part. So currently that's facilitated by Western unions and the MoneyGrams of the world, things like that, right? And they take anywhere from 3 to 9 or 10% on particular amounts to certain countries and whatever, which is bad because it's targeting people that need that money the most, right?
Yeah.
But I also understand that their compliance with the regulations and the fraud and so forth like that, you know, economically, that's the rate they have to charge to even service that region at all, right? So I kind of understand both sides there. But with Bitcoin, it's just so much easier to have so many different companies focusing on different countries. So there's a company called Rebit that focuses from Canada to Indonesia, Bitcoin remittance. It's like 0% or something, or it's like, less than 1%, in the tenths or something, there's markets from the United States to a couple African countries, but it's about complying with their laws too. So, there's certain economies of scale, maybe with countries that have very similar laws with regards to these types of things, but maybe if some of them are kind of different, it would make more sense for you to be the company people go to if they're going to be sending money to, fucking Guam or to, Madagascar or whatever. That having a multitude of those types of companies would be significantly better than having Western Union and MoneyGram and a few others be just this giant kind of ossified oligopoly and, dominate the whole system. And then if that happens, if some kind of picture like that paints out where these companies start dissolving into the Western Union territory, then that also furthers the impetus for the individuals just to use Bitcoin together and just cut out the fiat intermediary at all. And then there's no remittance problem anymore, right? If everyone is on Bitcoin, right? If there's a kind of hyper Bitcoinization occurs, right? Then remittance, that won't refer to anything. The whole like global wealth and purchasing power will shift radically, right? It's like the monetary walls of every nation are certain height, and Bitcoin just kind of punches through every nation's monetary walls.
Now, you think going after low-hanging fruit will help facilitate that coming faster? Like, what do you really mean by that? Like, what can be done to speed that process up?
So I guess those are different questions. What I mean is that I think it's important for people in third world countries or people that don't have adequate banking or, lending facilities or whatever to use Bitcoin and to rely on Bitcoin, because that is the kind of thing we need to have large liquid volume, to have large markets and large liquidity, right? So Bitcoin is volatile because it's illiquid, because anyone that wants to move $10 million in and out into and out of Bitcoin moves the price, right? That's volatile. It's not a stable currency, but that's because it's illiquid, because you're splashing around in a small pool. If there's 2 billion people or a billion people all across the world from Argentina and Venezuela and North Korea and whatever using Bitcoin, that is adding so many more resources to the possible market. That is adding so much more hands, right? Hands into the Bitcoin economy. And that provides the liquidity that the market needs for companies like Apple and Exxon to use Bitcoin at all. Like, it would be totally putting the cart before the horse to have like Apple or Exxon or these massive companies be put, buy for Bitcoin. And there's a huge Bitcoin rush and it overwhelms the network and it's this awful system, whatever. And then they have to like limp along and fix it years later or whatever. It's like, if they're going to be late to the game, they'll be late to the game. But it's better to have the billions of hands supporting this network, right, that provide it with global international liquidity, so that the massive corporate companies that earn, billions of dollars or tens of billions of dollars or whatever in income, that's a reliable payment channel for them, right? Now, whether they should exist or not is kind of a separate story. But that's what the article was part of about, is that people are putting the cart before the horse. You know, they're thinking that really the merchants are the important thing, and it's not. It's the under financially developed world.
I hear you. All right. Thank you, Mattheus. And we'll be back after this.
BlakeDevelopment.net is a moment
in it
creation, app
to where like it was like the perfect timing
to businesses of all sizes. There's really no job too big or too small for BlakeDevelopment.net.
Right.
Do you have an idea for a killer app?
Okay.
Are you missing out on online sales, or maybe your business needs help with social media?
Hey, what wallet
media?
Are you using?
Just $200 and they're offering 3 years of free domain registry. Yes, they take Bitcoin. 844 site 123. BlakeDevelopment.net. 844 site 123.
Like yeah, the other twice, whatever. I don't know if that's a transaction liability problem or if that's just an ICA problem or what, but I've also heard very good things, and I know very good things about Airbits and the Airbits wallet.
Yeah, Airbits is all the rage right now.
Yeah.
That's because what MK Lords is now like the head honcho there or something like that. I don't know.
Maybe, but I had to find a wallet for Alex Ball.
Isn't it nice that you have all these options?
Oh, absolutely. Tech guru, and she had like an iPad as all she was going to use. I was like, okay, I don't know anything about iOS like wallets, what's available. So I'd like read up on like 6 or 7 of them, like Red Wallet and Hive and Blockchain Wallet, all this different stuff. And Airbits came out consistently. Like, this is basically the closest thing that you're going to get to what you want on like a lockdown Apple device.
Expedia is like the best thing ever that takes Bitcoin, because we get to pay for like our entire honeymoon in Bitcoin.
That's awesome.
Another cool thing is we take, well, you know that we pay our rent in Bitcoin, which is, I know you say hoard it, but I'm still going to pay my rent in Bitcoin just because.
Well, that's more of a reason to hoard large lump sums of it.
I mean, if that's valuable to you, then you're just spending it on what is valuable.
Oh, I replace everything I buy. So if I spend it, like I'm going to replace it.
That's true. So you can do that. So I've talked to Matt Whitlock about that, and he says that that's what he does. He just buys the Bitcoin, and he, you know,
free press. I thought that was the bumper. Is it 21 or 19? One of my things. No, I need to.
Which is fine, but then he's still expressing that hoarding value because he's rebuying it afterwards. He's not like trying to dishoard.
Yeah.
He's trying to like retain his.
Well,
his
I think
stock.
It's more of a reason for us to keep buying so much of it. Like we have every reason to just buy large lump sums of it to have extra.
Yeah, I'm collecting Bitcoin that way. Newscast, FPP radio shows, and weekly news, views, and Jamie's makes pile.
That's true. And if you have some Bitcoins that you don't really want anymore, the Rebel Love Show does take accept donations in Bitcoin. You can get that in the Bitcoin wallet address is in the show notes right down there. If you're watching on YouTube, just feel free to, you know, send us a couple millibits.
And you're asking for a future small fortune.
I'm just asking for the pay to hosting of this show as a podcast. I'd be fine. I'd be happy with that. You know, this show isn't exactly cheap to do.
It's
my firm
belief. It's not.
Charitable dollar among the groups. Support all your it costs a lot of make sure you get $5 a month. Federal Reserve notes sometimes.
This is your Robertson Roberts Brokerage Daily Precious Metals Update. In early trading Tuesday,
but you cost a lot more though, babe.
$1,163
per ounce. You're lucky I spoiled you.
$5 per ounce. Bitcoin is trading at $250
US. That's true, you do spoil me.
Robertson Roberts Brokerage has been helping clients with buying and selling precious metals for nearly 40 years. Give us a call today. 800-874-9776.
I know. I got to go down to the Barber's Tool Shed again. Here, there's still some left there.
You can connect with Liberty Radio Network via our Facebook page at facebook.lrn.fm. That's facebook.lrn.fm.
And welcome back to the Rebel Love Show. And to right now, I kind of want to go in a different path and talk about drugs, because that's what we kind of do sometimes on the show, talk about how to change your perception of life. And Mattheus, you are a fellow psychonaut, and what got you down going into I mean, you do pot obviously, but you've gone into other stuff.
Can you do pot, or do you just smoke it?
Well, I don't consider pot a drug, but I mean, people do.
I don't know. Can you do caffeine or sugar?
Yeah, or everything. First of all, everything's alcohol, a drug.
Sugars.
I consider pot a drug. I also consider caffeine a drug. I consider, you know, too much TV a drug. McDonald's, like anything can be a drug. It's just, you know, it's how you use it and how much, I guess.
I don't know. I guess to answer your question, just curiosity, you know, and the continual degradation of the kind of official myths of the DARE program, kind of indoctrination that I'd carried with me for 10 more years and things like that, you know.
So DARE made you smoke do drugs?
No. I was just like misinformed and kind of kept from understanding what certain drugs were and what they did. And it took a while before that kind of conditioning wore off and my curiosity ended up winning out over, you know, however much conditioning I had left, and started trying stuff and experimenting.
I mean, the adults in my life as a child, they did drugs, but they never seemed to be having any fun. I don't really know how to explain it. They always seemed like they do these drugs and then they just be miserable. So all my life I was just like, well, I don't want to be miserable like those people. It wasn't DARE or anything,
right?
I always thought that was a bunch of shit, but I was like, these people aren't having any fun. And then I tried it for myself, and then I just realized they're miserable people.
Yeah,
you know, that's all that is. They're just miserable.
Well, so many people use it as a crutch or as a way to like self-medicate. Right.
They're expecting it to do all the work for them.
Yeah, yeah, like no one should ever do any drug as a like self-medical.
No,
help,
it should enhance who you are as a person, and I think that is probably why we're all psychonauts. We're all, you know, we're just trying to we're trying to reach that next level.
Mattheus, what is something that you've been wanting to do that you haven't done yet? Is there anything out there that you're still curious about?
Well, there's plenty of stuff in there, I guess. I mean, I don't know. I mean, are you pointing to certain drugs?
No, I don't know. I'm just curious. I mean, you don't have to answer. I was just curious.
Can I say, there was one guy who came here on a trip. I'm not going to say his name, but I think his name was TJ. And he came here and he was saying how he was the square. He didn't really drink before, but he was here and he was like here to live his life. And then we seen him like 2 days later and he was like, yeah, like I smoked weed for the first time. I did coke. And then he goes, and then I did meth.
Yeah.
And then
he was saying he was trying, it was his goal to like try each drug that's ever been made.
Yeah. He was like, I did meth. And we just kind of looked at him because he was already kind of just like this off guy.
Yeah. He was way off.
We were like, what? You did meth? Like, everyone froze and said the exact same. What? You did meth?
Why and then how would you do
meth? Like, why would you do meth? And I think, I mean, you can ask people, like, what they want to try and everything. And some people have some really good answers, you know, and some good reasons why. Like, so, you know, I want to try shrooms. I want to see, like, the colors of the world. I want to try, like, coke. I want to be energized. Like, I want to try meth because I want to be like, what is the reason?
Like bounce off the walls and like fixate on like one certain thing. I don't know.
Is that the side effects of meth? I don't know.
Well, you haven't seen Breaking Bad. That's right.
No,
you
know, I haven't seen it.
You know what's weird? So here's something that I noticed. So some people defend certain drugs and other people attack certain drugs, right? But if somebody has never tried, so there's an argument that if somebody has never tried a certain drug, then they can't comment on it, right? Like you don't know, you've never smoked pot, you don't know how good it is, whatever. But that's true of any drug that one party doesn't know about, so you can use it in any case, which is kind of like it's kind of like religion in that sense, where it's like, well, you didn't grow up Catholic, so you don't know how I'm really saved and how all of you guys are, you know, are going to hell or whatever. It's like every argument for this particular religion or that particular religion, they're all the same, you know, they're all the same type of argument with the same thing with drugs here. So it's like, well, you know, if somebody came to me and said that they were kind of reluctant or hesitant to smoke pot and they didn't know about it, this or that, or if they were actually hostile to it, if they were attacking pot smoking, I don't know that I would be able to use any type of argument to convince them or persuade them, whatever, that somebody who was trying to defend like heroin or meth wouldn't also use to somebody that was like,
well, criticizing
meth or heroin.
I don't try to defend any drug. Like, if someone came up to me and was curious, I'd just say, you know, it's, I like it, this is why I like it, you know, you can or cannot try it. But if someone comes up to me and they're like, you know, I do meth, like, and I want to ask you about meth, like, I feel differently. Like, I still feel like that's their choice, you know, but I'm definitely not gonna say, I mean, I'm not gonna condone it in any way or like defend, like, oh, I don't know, I didn't try it. Like, oh, great, that's like hand clap for me, don't try that.
I'll defend anyone wanting to do any drug, you know, but I would not tell a single person to do, you know, meth or heroin or whatnot.
I'd say just as long as it's not, I mean, no, I've done some unnatural things, but at least I could probably name an ingredient. Like, meth is just like Clorox and like whatever else you can find lying around.
True.
So I don't know.
Well, I'm just saying, I mean, that just proves the point though. Like, I could be referring to actual Clorox. I could have Clorox. I'm like, dude, this is amazing. You get so high from this. You gotta try this. Dude, that's fucking Clorox in your hands. Yeah. You don't know. You've never done this before. But just trust me. It's better. You know, the other thing that we've done before, yeah, it's better than that. So just trust me. Right? It's the same type of argument that you would use if somebody didn't smoke, had never smoked pot. So it's like, you try to think of what, you know, what the line is. Where is the line? For it's like, beyond these are drugs that I can't even countenance. I can't even pardon somebody for doing these. But anything before this line, well, that's fine. I'll shake their hand. And
well, my question is, when it comes to harder drugs besides pot, do you think someone should just straight up do it if they're curious, or do you think they should actually build it up mentally to prepare themselves for like doing something different, like read up on it, like do your research on, you know, how you will feel and, you know, are you ready like mentally? Because you really shouldn't take like, you know, shrooms if you're really depressed or something like that. You know, in my opinion, I don't think anyone really should.
I mean, I don't think shrooms is a party drug. I remember my first time doing it, I didn't do any research.
Yeah, well, I think
I should have.
I think it's unique to the person. Like, you know, people should do research on what type of food they put in their body, or their other types of drugs, whatever prescription drugs that they put in their body. But they don't do that either. So I don't know. It's up to each person. You know, I research before I ever get involved in something new like that. But some people like to be a little bit more laissez-faire and just go for it.
Well, TJ went crazy.
He just went for it.
Don't do all the drugs, kids.
Don't do all of the drugs.
On Free Talk Live, we're bringing people to the ideas of liberty.
And they found him in like a bathtub or something.
I remember hearing something like he was like,
yeah.
I didn't know that.
No, he died. TJ's dead.
And you made fun of him on air?
They had to pull the plug.
And you made fun of him on air. That's a bad omen, babe.
I didn't make fun of him. He did math and then he went crazy. Like, this is literally what happened. He was a cool dude before.
Was this the guy that was using a roll of paper towels as a sponge? Yes. This guy?
Yeah.
Oh my God.
I'll always remember that. I'll always remember him trying. He spilled his drink and he was using an entire roll of paper towels.
On the ground.
As a sponge.
Oh my God.
And everyone just stopped what they were doing. Like, everyone just stopped and looked. And I was like, no,
rest
man.
In peace, rest in peace.
That's like my only memory of him. That is my memory of the guy.
Stopping it with the whole world.
Yes. Just because someone's dead, it doesn't make them a saint, you know? Yeah, exactly. Like, exactly. You still can talk about the memories you have of them when they're alive. And that's, there's just few.
but now you can get a 25%
You gotta put that at the end of the video.
All right, babe. So what we come up with next?
I think he's in my Seditious Sirens intro video.
Do this right. What? Don't
wait. I think he's in my Seditious Sirens intro video.
You can buy them through ExpressCoin.com with a check or money order. There are other ways to get Bitcoin, but that's fast, safe, and easy. This information is worth you changing the way you do things. Go to saveitpurse.com right now, get signed up, and cash in on the huge raise I'm offering you. 15 to 25% off of everything at Amazon through saveitpurse.com. It's saveatpurse.com.
Did you know that Free Aid is a mutual aid, educational, and networking organization? At Free Aid, we support volunteers who provide first aid. We do outreach to the public about health and safety, and we bring together medically skilled freedom lovers. Free Aid is made possible by your generous support.
Yeah, I want to talk about psychedelics because, like first aid kits, t-shirts, cards, and hoodies.
The Free Aid Silver Dime Card Project we is haven't done in part by Robertson Roberts Brokerage.
Oh, I
know. I feel like I did mushrooms one good time, you know?
I only have one good trip on mushrooms.
One really good trip. FM is proud to announce our official listening apps for Android and
iOS devices. I'm down for doing shrooms again with you.
But like, that's on your smartphone or tablet.
We gotta plan it out. That's a day event.
Yeah.
Or search for LRN.FM in the Android or Apple App Stores. Please download, rate it 5
like,
stars,
I cried for like 8 hours. I'm good with not doing shrooms for the rest of the year.
You're listening to LRN.FM. Download it now.
Yeah.
Free at apps.lrn.fm. That's apps.lrn.fm.
Oh. Money. I can't wait to dance with you. Keenevention all rolling. Credit,
success secrets I can't wait. .com. Be That's seen cool. as an industry leader. You can do it. The last application.
We don't do it that often.
Time to hit submit.
Which is good. I'm glad we.
I think we do it. We teach you exactly what to place. I think we do it more than
the average person. Yeah, because the average person doesn't at all.
Yeah,
average person is business credit. Important.
Many people will get cash on the spot. Use those two tools.
I mean, it's not like we're gonna die. Engine.
So you can walk into the bank or and maybe. Get your project funded today.
If I'm taking it in a time relief capsule.
Hey, babe. .com. If I ever die,
secrets reveal is explosive and ignites instant results.
I want to die happy knowing that you got to experience life with you.
You want me to OD with you?
No. Please don't.
Or
While our satellite channel is free to listen to, it's not free for us. You can help
Did
us
you know what we're heard in side of the page at in Africa? FM.
And welcome back to the Rebel Love Show. Before we left, we were talking with MVG here about psychedelics and, you know, tripping and what you should try, what you maybe should probably, you know, not try if it involves like needles or any like kind of physical task other than breathing. Oh my God. So off topic, but whatever. So recent experience, helium. That was my first time. It was back when I was going to become a puppy mother, and the night before, kids. Yeah.
She's such a responsible puppy mother.
I am.
Let's do a bunch of helium and stay up all night and then go pick up the
dog.
Wait,
is it helium or nitrous? What is it?
I thought it was nitrous, actually.
Nitrous. Yeah, is that what it's called? I had laughing gas, whatever. I had, like, seen a documentary about, like, these people who were, like, addicted to it or whatever. And I didn't want to try it at first. So, you know, I sat back and I thought about it. And, I looked at it in my mind and I was, like, laughing gas. You know, they give it to you at the doctor. I've never had it before, but... In the end, my decision was, why the hell not? So, I mean, that was the conclusion I came to. So I tried it and I loved it. I was so glad that I, you know, tried that, that I took that opportunity to try something I had never tried before. And I had a good result. I've done that and I've gotten really bad results, even with simple things like pot brownies. Like,
yeah, you know, your body does not work with edibles in any way,
shape, or form. Like, you live and you learn. And, you know, I learned that fucking nitrous is awesome. So it's just everything in moderation at that point. But I really recommend, if it's your life, you know, you got one life, maybe, unless we hit the singularity.
Then so we have
you still only have one life.
Well,
no, you can keep cloning yourself. You can have an infinite amount of you. Oh, you can have infinite amount of lives from the singularity.
But my still point be you. Is, all those infinite amounts.
It'd be all of them.
All those
they'll all be linked.
All those infinite with, amounts the of you should take risks and chances, because you have to live. You have to try these things at least once. Maybe not meth, but, like, you know, something that you have to, like, put in your mind, what are the dangers versus what
Mattheus,
are the rewards.
Mattheus, would you do, just on the record, will you ever do crocodile?
What is that, heroin?
I will never do crocodile.
Okay.
What is,
right, I'm just making sure.
What is crocodile?
Oh, it's isn't it like a Russian heroin or
and
something?
And it makes
like
your skin turn into like a crocodile.
Yeah. Homemade drug.
Yeah, it's some homemade like crazy.
Manchester has a huge heroin epidemic.
Yeah, there was a I think I told a story before, but there's this one time every once in a while I will give a hitchhiker a ride. It's a
which
weird
is
thing.
Weird.
Interesting.
Okay. Yeah. Anyways, I'm trying. It's when we're living at the old place. So, Ann works on one side of the city. I take Granite to go to the other side of the city, drop her off, and come back. And on my way back, I'm at the light, and this woman comes up and, you know, asks, hey, can you give me a ride to Elm? I'm like, I'm driving toward Elm. I'm like, it's like four blocks. I'm like, whatever. Like, sure. And she starts talking about, why she was up so early in the morning. This is like, you know, 8 o'clock in the morning. And she's saying she had to pay her, she was paying for her, addiction, and is literally pointing at like the needle marks on her arms. And basically saying that she was selling her services and, you know,
damn,
that's the pay for the heroin, or just that was the payment for the heroin. I don't know. And we had a very interesting conversation for like the next 5 minutes where I was like, you know what? I have no problem with you selling your services to, you know, you own your body, you do you. I wouldn't agree with it, but go do you. But if you're going to do drugs, do like good drugs, like mushrooms, or like even go to acid or something like that. Like, why go to heroin?
Right.
Like, why like, you
how,
know,
how
do, a,
get there?
Do a roll of the dice on your life.
Yeah.
You know?
I don't think I'll ever take acid.
Oh,
you don't think so?
No, because I
thought you wanted to at one point.
I did, but then I know people who've done acid who are like perma tripping. Like,
you get flashbacks from what a lot of people say.
They are never coming back. And I don't know if acid's to blame or they're just shitty people. Like I said, you know, my childhood, all the adults, and they were just shitty, but I don't know. I feel like maybe sometimes if you do a drug that alters your, like, your state of mind, like, what if it permanently alters it and you can't come back from that, and that makes you just like a crazy person who draws on walls?
Yeah. Well, you know, with everything, you know, you got to know your limits and how far you can go. Some people want to go that far. They want to see how far they can go.
They want to fall down the rabbit hole forever. And
some people, you know, it's like doing Inception on yourself. You'll fall down and never come back out.
Sure.
You know, that's my whole fear of like doing any new drug. It's like, I don't want to keep going down. You know, it's already getting to the point where like pot almost has like no effect on me anymore.
Yeah, but pot's pot, you know.
But it used to affect me good. I used to get so high and so happy. And
then
now it's like,
you know, only smoke every 2 or 3 days.
I do. And that lasts for like the first bowl. And after that, I'm like back to square one.
Damn.
Yeah, it sucks.
I still get high, but it's because I'm the high priestess. So anyway, I mean, if there is one drug that I do want to take,
what would that be?
Opium.
Oh, why opium?
I don't know. I've been reading a lot about opium, and I think it's just a very natural drug that probably makes you feel really good. Or I'd probably vomit. I don't know.
My bucket list drug.
What's your bucket list drug?
I want to go down to the Amazon and have ayahuasca. A shaman. Yes, give me some ayahuasca. Yes.
Let's do ayahuasca together. Would you, Mattheus? Ayahuasca?
Yeah, well, if the conditions present itself, that seems pretty cool.
If we can all fly down to the Amazon, I'll do ayahuasca together. Will you come with us?
That depends on.
That's a bucket list moment. Like, when are you gonna? If you had that opportunity,
if we just drove by it, Mateus, we're like, get in the plane.
We're going down to the Amazon.
I don't know. I think some people that we know actually went down to like South America to do that. So I don't know if you can like book trips down there regularly or.
I'm not saying
it's impossible. A lot of people do that.
Yeah,
I'm just saying like, you don't get that many opportunities to like just pick up and fly and go somewhere.
That's true.
I wish we could find it here. I mean, I've heard, okay, ayahuasca is supposed to be like your mega trip that like all like puts you in touch with reality, I guess. That scary? You got to be ready for that. That has to be at a certain point in your life.
Well, you just have – you got to build yourself up.
Because if you're
– I wouldn't even say I'm ready for it right now. I say it's on my bucket list. I'm going to get there. But I'm not – I wouldn't even say I'm ready to take ayahuasca yet. I'm not – I am not prepared mentally to even do that yet.
Yeah, not yet.
Yeah.
A few years from now maybe. Like after we've had kids and settled down.
That's like a shire decade from now.
Yeah. And then we can do ayahuasca. And go up there.
So once I have kids, it's okay to do the harder drugs.
That's what I was thinking too. How does that work?
Should I be doing the harder drugs like before we have kids and get it out of our system? Not to where like, oh, we have other human beings that we're responsible for. Let's do all the harder drugs.
What? It's not like we're going to do ayahuasca every day. And when you have kids, your life doesn't end. You can still do drugs. You just have to do drugs responsibly.
Well, I guess it was more.
God, so many people would take that line the wrong way.
Like, I don't care.
Just because you have kids doesn't mean you still can't stop doing drugs.
Why? Like, I mean, I know plenty of parents who, you know, don't just stop their lives because they have kids. Like,
that's true.
They're not, you know, spending their last dollar on a fucking dime bag, but they're still like smoking their tweed and like having dinner for their kids at night. Like, it's all in moderation, you know?
All right. Moderate drug users, parents.
Moderate.
Be responsible.
Responsible drug users.
Toke responsibly.
Toke responsibly.
Understanding your credit score is the first step. Speaking towards of managing responsibly, and
improving it. There
you go. This is Charlie Sundstrom with
you're good. You're good.
The most influential component of your credit score is
that's
your
true.
Payment
okay.
history.
We'll leave
almost
it
equally as important is the amount pay. You owe on credit
He's,
accounts. Also impacting your score.
I'm not off.
Your degree.
You're not smoking
every,
me out of the table.
Every adult, I grew up with
the number of new accounts,
what?
Credit inquiries, and your various types of credit accounts.
They put to help kids achieve in other rooms and a
healthy credit score. Have a system.
That wasn't the case with me. Nobody I knew growing up as a kid, not until high school. Like, I never saw any parent smoke weed, any cousin, any aunt or uncle, friend. I never saw it.
Everyone smoked weed all the fucking time. Everyone's like drug dealers. I seen crack when I was like 5. Like, it was the South.
Yeah.
Drugs were like no big deal.
Damn.
That's why when I was like,
if you listen to Free Talk Live regularly,
whatever. I don't know.
Yeah, that was not that was not.
That's like how every household is. And I was like, I don't know. Open and honesty is better, though.
No, I hear you.
I'm still going to smoke weed when I have kids. Believe that. I'm going to be fucking Earth Mother. To the time my child comes of age and asks to sit in the circle.
Mateus, what is a good age to give your kids pot?
They should buy it for themselves. No one bought me pot.
What?
When they ask for it?
What if they ask for it at 5 years old? Maybe they have the internet. They can figure out how to put it in a pipe. And light it with a lighter and inhale.
This is Anne's guide on parenting. First of all, I'm not buying my kids pot because no one ever bought me pot. Like, no one ever bought me alcohol. Like, you better fucking become an entrepreneur. You better put in for this dime bag. Including Oath Keeper, but they can smoke up. Libertarian
presidential candidate. Yeah, I don't know. That's an interesting question. I mean, I would probably what I would do is Representative Mike Sylvia rated alter. It's kind of cruel, I guess, but it's the only way to do it without like using force. Probably would be to alter the conditions of what I give them, such that if they do this, they'll lose other things more worthwhile. It's like, yeah, I guess you can smoke, but if you do, that means that I'm revoking these and that privileges.
I feel like if you're open and honest with your like kids, or if you like you don't change who you are, like say we use drugs, we don't feel like there's no victim, there's no crime, like like I said, every adult in my life always smoked when I grew up, so I never grew up like, oh, where's the weed, like I need to sneak and do this, like I never felt that way ever, and I was never curious about drugs or wanting to like sneak around and smoke drugs, like it never interested me. Because I seen people do it, and you would think it's like the opposite. Like your kid will be asking you for weed. Like I never was like, where's the weed at? Like I don't, like it was something I like eventually grew up in like research and wanted to try myself for myself. But we shall see. New Hampshire, and you can join us and help.
That's not a good point. Sign up now at freestateproject.org.
Help get LRN.FM into more ears. Visit promote.lrn.fm for a free bumper sticker, flyers, banners, graphics, like and more. Promote.lrn.fm.
And welcome back to the Rebel Love Show. We're sitting here with Mattheus Von Guttenberg. Did I say that right?
You did.
MVG is his name. He's the Bitcoin guru. We're talking about psychonaut journeys and whatnot, and when will we be mentally ready to do the hard drugs? I once watched a movie. I don't remember what it was called, but it was basically people like went to sleep in this machine, and then they woke up and they're like, they're projected. They had like robot bodies. I don't really know. Like they were like robots, and they were living like this virtual reality. And the one guy, he didn't plug in. It was just like a trend. They were trying to make them affordable so everyone could buy a robot body. And they had like these drugs for these people's robots. And one of them was just like this thing where you like zap yourself and it like gives you like this kind of energy, and it's like a drug that all the robots do or whatever, zapping. I wonder, would there ever be a drug like that's technology based? Like,
absolutely. I think we get to a point where
what would it be? Nanites. Like tech,
I don't know, techno MDMA. Sort of, you'll have some sort of nanites that in your blood system or in your nervous system that can alter your consciousness, that you'll actually be able to control with your consciousness. So you can give yourself a 24/7 high whenever you want. Like, isn't that that's not out of the realm of possibilities?
It's not out of the realm of possibility. It just requires a lot more knowledge about like neuroscience and chemical interactions and pathways in the brain and things like that. Like, I guess it's theoretically possible to know about it. That's just like a lot. Like, that's just not an easy jump.
Yeah, no, I know. It's going to take a long time.
What would come first? I think maybe they would invent some kind of thing where, you know, like it shocked you, like a shocker, like some kind of chip.
Uh-huh.
And then I don't know, that gives you like visions or something. The drug, but that, only for so long.
Well,
I don't know.
The drug that I want, that I would love to take, is like based off the whole limitless drug, a drug that you can literally evolve your mind, your mental capabilities by taking a drug.
Well, I feel like the limitless, the thing with that is, like, that's evolution. Like, if you're evolved to that point, like, your basic skills become, like, almost magic. Like, you're...
Yeah, yeah. Right. Yeah. If you're... It's like, for like the... how all the life on the planet is basically powered by the sun, right? It's like... All that crazy variety and all the stuff that's happening, all the plants and the life and everything, single source of energy, right?
Yeah.
It's just like that heat, that light. And so everything else, the whole planet that receives it is like, you know, like growing and having animals on it and all this like swirling life that otherwise would just be like a fucking barren rock or whatever. But because of the sun and whatever, it's like, you know, there's magic on it now.
Yeah. I just feel like if you, I don't know, the limitless drug would be good. But you got to think about it, and they were trying to make that so it lasted forever, and you have to keep taking it. So eventually, yeah, that's what they, you have to, like, keep taking it.
So,
you have to.
Why not?
What I wonder.
I would take it every day. I'd take it every hour.
Yeah, but then they.
Yeah, give it to me.
They
sure, I'd take it every second.
How to make it an IV.
But the thing is, they eventually have to figure out a way where you could have it constantly, like, pumping through your bloodstream. But everyone would need that. What if everyone did that? Then, you know, we're all like this omnipresent human.
That'd be awesome. I don't want but evolution then at that to point, be held back just then, to the elite few. I would love every single human being to be raised up.
I'm not saying it shouldn't. I'm just saying that if that were the case, that would happen, and then we'd evolve. That's why, you know, I don't think it's the drug that'll happen. I feel like technology will lead us there before a pill does.
Well, technology can be that limitless.
Yeah,
drug.
Technology is the limitless drug, basically.
Good point. Interesting. Yeah.
I mean, I would think we can get there somehow. That'd be my drug of choice if I had to pick one that I really wanted.
What will happen, I think, hopefully with a combination of 3D printing and understandings of, you know, medical biology and being able to replicate scientific experiments and things like that, there'll be markets for different body enhancements, right? Different manufacturers, different people that make prosthetic limbs, right? That already exists, right? And people don't really think of prosthetic limbs as a way of, like, you know what we talk about as far as transhumanism is concerned.
Yeah, it's someone with an augmented body.
It is exactly right. I'm wearing contacts right now, and that's augmenting my vision physically.
Yeah, but I mean, I guess if I can invent a drug, it would be something like helium that lasts for like 10 seconds, but gave you like the greatest freak out of your entire existence. Like, it just like a mega trip in like 2 seconds.
That's what a lot of people say about salvia.
I've never tried salvia though.
No, neither have I.
It's literally like a almost DMT-esque trip for just like 10 seconds. Whoa. Or maybe 30 seconds, like a really short one. Something I've always wanted to try. I've never actually got a chance to do it, though.
Well, if we have the kind of like technology that we were talking about, right, as far as reaching a singularity, that implies that we're now on a different kind of evolutionary path than biological evolution, right? And biological evolution has a certain kind of system of checks and balances and a certain way of making sure that only those that are most environmentally fit to survive actually do survive and reproduce, right? If all of our body parts and the nanoparts and the organs and, you know, the brain, even perhaps in these examples, can be like taken to silicon or different machines or different things or whatever, then it becomes like an open source technological evolutionary path. It becomes multi-directional, you know, different types of attachments and limbs will do this and different types of enhancements will do that. And this company does this a little bit better than that company. And
so where do you see, like, what do you see? I thought I had this as a question, but I guess I don't see it. I know Rob thinks the singularity will probably happen within the next 2 generations.
No. About 2 generations from now. I would say, I mean, I'm not an expert, but what from all futurists I've read about, they usually point to around 2045.
So 2045, but when, at what point do you think that we will reach a level where we're able, you know, like you say, like there'll be that app where we can download that body part or whatever, or we could.
I mean, we've already gotten to a point now where we're so far advanced from where we were just 100 years ago, well, alone 1,000 or sure. 2,000 or 10,000 years ago. It's getting to the point where we're literally, I view technology as more than just a tool. You know, like this isn't, this piece of plastic around here on this lighter is not just a lighter. I'm literally controlling fire with like my thoughts, and fire is shooting out with this piece of technology.
Right.
You that's know? All, but that's
it's like, an extension of it's your extension, hand.
Yeah.
But I'm when, not using it when as a fire tool, can like shoot out from your phone, then we talk. Like,
but I mean, we're getting to the point where we're using technology to already augment what we can do as human beings.
And I was just thinking about this. I'm interested in augmented reality, right, which is distinct from virtual reality, which is a completely separate environment or overlay or whatever. The augmented reality is a digital overlay of the physical world. So, you know, the example was like Microsoft's HoloLens that I saw some videos on the internet a while ago. It was showing some guy interacting with like widgets on a part of his wall, a like physical wall, whatever that was, like his mail, or he sent this to that thing, or he just did some kind of basic computer task using these imaginary three-dimensional augmented constructs that were in physical, you know, his physical view space. And that would just be fascinating for all of the use cases. Just like, for instance, like I was just walking today, or I was getting out of work, walking in the parking lot, and some guy kind of like pulled out into the lane a little bit quicker than I thought, and I had to like kind of jump out of the way or whatever. You know, it was like a weird moment. And I just thought that it would be so easy, or it would be so great to have like directional arrows that show where the car intends to go. Like the driver could just signal that it's like, oh, the second or the third spot right there, I'm going to aim for that. And so that like I could be able to tap in and see that this is where he is going, or where he intends to go, or whatever. And I can make more informed decision. And then going back to physical reality, you know, you would just see a bunch of things moving around, and it's like, oh, damn it, where are all the shortcuts and the directions and the guides, and where are the little like icons and the blips or the whatever?
Well, yeah. I mean, like with augmented vision like that or anything, where you'd see this in front of you, you know,
yeah, like a heads up display.
That's why, like with Google Glass, you know, that's defunct now, but like that was like the dream where, like, you know, you have GPS navigation right in front of you while you're driving. So it's in your corner peripheral of your vision. You know, you have that GPS navigation. You don't have to look down at your cell phone, or even if you have it mounted up, you know, it's there in it.
It's all that government regulation hindering technology.
So what?
Well, that did prevent Amazon from launching drones.
You said it's defunct now?
Well, where can we find you, MVG?
Yeah, they're not coming out with Google Glass anymore.
Oh.
Yeah. Yeah, where can they find you at?
You can find me online. You can find me on Facebook.
Where's that website? It's been like two Shire years.
Under construction. It has not been.
You can find us on therebelocia.com. Donate.
Peace, guys.
Peace.
Peace.
Republicans back a plan for universal lawn care, and an RC car works up the courage to approach a group of girls. And now.